grad students, so I don't know.
Here.
I can use my clipboard just in case I want to.
You guys ready? All right, I think we'll get started. Hello, everyone. My name is Adam Wood. I'm the president of the Federalist Society, and welcome to our first event of the year. I think you all know why we're here. Good old healthcare debate. In the middle, arguing for the single-payer system, we have Adam Broad. He is an organizer with the Illinois Single-Payer Coalition and a public servant as Vernon Township Trustee. He volunteers as a co-organizer for Our Revolution Lake County, Lakefront Democratic Socialists of America, and the National Lawyers Guild Environmental Justice Committee. You can access his personal blog at broadsheet.info, and his Twitter is Broad Coalition, and the Illinois Single Payer Coalition is ilsinglepayer.org, and they believe that healthcare is a human right, and that a nation as strong and wealthy as the United States can and must provide its residents with high-quality healthcare. On the other side, we have Roger Klein. He is an expert with the Federalist Society's Regulatory Transparency Project. He previously worked for the HHS, the CMS, and CDC, and is a leading authority on public policies related to the implementation of precision medicine. He is a physician and an attorney. He previously worked as the medical director of molecular oncology at Cleveland Clinic and served in leadership roles in many cancer-related professional society committees, including being the current chair of the Association for Molecular Pathology's Solid Tumors Division. Recently, he has been going on speaking visits, talking about vaping policies, and you can visit his website at rogerdklein.com. And serving as our moderator for the debate is Professor Courtney Hughes. She is an associate professor of public health for the School of Health Studies here at NIU. She received her PhD in health services from the University of Washington, her master's in kinesiology from Michigan, and a bachelor's degree in finance and economics from Notre Dame. She currently teaches classes on health systems in the United States, public health, and researches health economics. And with that, I'll turn it over to Adam Broad.
Hey. Hi, I'm Adam Broad. In discussing why I'm advocating single-payer healthcare, I'd just like to start out with a few simple points. One is the cost of our current system. When we have our school year presentations, we have these forums where we have our certified experts use our source material and talk about this issue. We have a little handy chart that shows percentage of GDP, and as you know, if you look at the United States on a graph, it's a skyrocket toward 25% of our GDP for our current system. All the other countries, they're rising, but they're not rising as radically as our system. Most of the bankruptcies in our country come from medical costs. Most of those bankruptcies happen to people who have health insurance. When they or their loved one get sick, what's the point? And then there's the results. Out of 19 wealthy nations, the United States ranks 19th in birth mother mortality rate. So sort of on par with more of a developing country rather than a wealthy country. We have the worst infant mortality rate. If you look at our life expectancies, they don't run par with our wealth and status as a nation. They, like I said, they're more on par with developing countries up to a point, as if you were looking on one of our graphs, you would see that at age 65, our outcomes start to shoot up again. And that's because once we make it through the donut hole and get on Medicare, all of a sudden your outcomes start to improve. And well, why is that? It's because we have a healthcare system that's incentivized for profit. Private insurance is based on for-profit, not providing health. Executives get massive bonuses for figuring out ways to jack you out of your coverage. It runs contrary to the general welfare of our country. So the remedy is to eliminate a vast, costly, convoluted corporate bureaucracy, which is a giant suck of our healthcare dollars that do not go to providing healthcare for the American people. This is a remedy that eliminates a number of other social problems that come out of this convoluted system. Stagnant wages and declining productivity. But we're more like, we're focused on getting people well and giving them the healthcare they deserve. And so I'm advocating for a single payer system, and I'm sure we'll have more chance to talk about it as we go on. I'd also encourage anyone who's interested to sign up to host one of our school years forums so that we could have one of our certified speakers come in and give the full sourced presentation with all the citations of studies and the actual hard numbers that back up the claims I'm going to be making here today. So see me after the event. Got my clipboard. If you know an event, an organization, a venue, or you're just more interested in more information, please get on my list. And that's all. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming. Thank you very much to Adam for inviting me and to Professor Hughes for moderating this discussion and to Adam for participating. So when we talk about Medicare for All, which has been endorsed by several major presidential candidates, what we're really talking about is replacing our current private and federal health insurance system with a single-payer government run system. It's actually not Medicare, it's anything but Medicare, it's elimination of Medicare. And what it does is it creates a new system and folds everybody into a single payer system. As proposed by, I think the most well-known plan is that of Senator Sanders, it offers a broad range of services, much, much broader than Medicare itself, without co-payments, premiums, or deductibles to everybody. So basically, we're giving much more to everybody. And it's and the fundamental fundamentally based on the false notion or premise that although taxes will go up, we as a society would pay less for health care because administrative savings due to the government's elimination of administrative costs. The first false premise that adheres to this discussion is the notion that somehow Medicare's administrative costs are understated, and that isn't even talking are cheap. That Medicare's administrative costs are actually less expensive than the private sector. It's not true. It's really an issue of measurement. And again, we're not talking about Medicare here, we're talking about a government system. But generally, comparisons of administrative costs typically look at a cost per dollar spent rather than administrative cost per enrollee. And because Medicare patients are sicker and more expensive to care for, their choices, on average, twice as costly as those in private plans. And administrative costs are based mostly on the number of beneficiaries. The percentage of costs based on expenses understates Medicare's administrative expenses relative to private insurance. So right off the bat, the comparison's wrong, and Medicare, in fact, it's actually more expensive. So Medicare's administrative cost per beneficiary consistently exceeds that of private insurance. Many of Medicare's administrative costs are borne by other agencies like Social Security, which collects the premiums, IRS, which collects the taxes, and HHS, which pays for building and marketing costs, other accounting-related concerns. All of these are off Medicare's books. Administrative costs are also measured by the difference between premiums paid less claims paid out. States commonly tax insurance premiums. That's also counted as an administrative cost for private insurers. And private insurers actually provide more than Medicare does for the service they offer: disease management, on-call nurse consultations at times. One thing that's really, really important is that, and I can tell you this as a physician, is that Medicare is horrific at utilization management and fraud and abuse reduction. It spends less on utilization management, and this generates overall, on the accounting sheets, it lowers administrative costs, but it results in much greater medical costs overall. And then finally, there's, and this is kind of an esoteric economic consideration, but there is what's called a large what's called an excess tax burden. That's because, and for those who want to look it up, it's called excess tax burden. It's the lost economic value due to distortions related to taxation, and that's because current taxpayers fund Medicare. So basically, when we look at Medicare as it is now, and again, what we're proposing is something vastly larger. We cover 60 million beneficiaries in a certainly non-comprehensive way. We're talking about adding 270 million people to the system. Now, Medicare in its current form is financially unsustainable. It's plagued by dramatic cost increases. Part A will be insolvent in 2026. To make Medicare financially stable for the long term, sustainable, we'd have to cut all expenses today by 19%.
Okay, but I'm just going to pause right there. So let's let Mr. Broad have some comments as a rebuttal to his opening statements, and then we'll go back just to keep this equal timing.
Well, I'm getting used to being dragged into the weeds on the cost for this thing. But I'm having a hard time grasping how eliminating a vast corporate bureaucracy makes it more expensive. You're eliminating $90 million bonuses to CEOs to figure out ways to deny you coverage. If you look at and it's true that there are some issues with ways in Medicare, but if you look at the overhead costs in the private sector, they're actually tremendously higher, about five times. Let's just say it's only three times. Still, if an elephant is a mouse built to government specifications, the private insurance industry is some kind of gigantic beast beyond our imagination, and it's hard to fathom it. Mr. Klein pointed out how the single payer is gonna eliminate government, private. Well, that's the point. We have all these different bureaucracies to manage healthcare. Single payer simplifies the bureaucratic costs and puts those dollars towards healthcare. Some plans suggest a tax increase. A tax increase is not necessary. We had a war in Iraq without a tax increase. We bailed out the banks without a tax increase. We signed in $1 trillion onto our defense budget, which included more nuclear weapons, storing nuclear waste, which is probably not even in the budget, that we are going to have to store infinitum for thousands and thousands of years. We're going to have to store that nuclear waste. How are we going to pay for it? Arguments about that. Why is it that when we're talking about a social program to save lives and livelihoods and boost our economy at the same time, by the way, how is it that with this we have all this scrutiny? I don't get it. I think that there's flawed priorities here, because we're talking about human lives that we can save, as opposed to bragging that we're the world's largest suicide bomber.
Okay, thank you.
anyway, that's what I have to say about that. And yeah, it's not Medicare for all per se. There's a lot of plans that call themselves Medicare for all or Medicare for America or Medicaid. Improved and expanded Medicare for all is the single payer. And that's the key point. Single payer. The federal government. One kitty, one source. My wife, Dr. Mrs. Girlfriend, doesn't have to spend 25% of her day on the phone with the insurance people fighting the bureaucracy to take care of her patients.
Okay, so one of the points that Adam made was he talked about health outcomes, and I do want to address those statistics because they sound alarming, and they are. And what they're reflective of is not healthcare is paid by insurance as we typically think about it. What they're talking about, and what we're really looking at, is measures of population health. And these are, medicine does a little bit, right? But what's really important are the social determinants of health. For example, if you look at our infant mortality rate, it's very hard to compare because we do much, much more for example, for premature infants. But the real problem is that we have a very high level of low infant birth rate children, mostly or predominantly weighted toward teen pregnancies. So again, this is not a medical issue. It's a societal health issue. And if you look at our medical outcomes, and so we sort of look, you know, when you look at insurance, it typically covers of costs of unpredictable and potentially extremely expensive things that can befall you serious illnesses. If you look at our ratings, for example, in oncology and cancer, we are among the top in most cancers in terms of the outcomes if you get sick. If you have a heart attack, your 30-day mortality in the United States is better than just about anywhere. When we look at life expectancy, the best life expectancy in the world is in Japan. But and they have National Health Service that pays 70%. If you look who's right next to us at the bottom in that measure is Great Britain with a a National Health Service. And the reason for it, again, is social determinants of health, population health, not medical care, which is typically what medicine pays for. So if you want to make an argument that we should spend more money on social determinants of health, I think that's a legitimate argument. And it's one that certainly would have a bigger impact on health than medical care. We're not performing poorly on medical care. The design of our system makes it inordinately expensive and we do too much. Our federal programs particularly have trouble preventing fraud and abuse. But population health is primarily determined by other factors, not medical delivery per se. I was talking to Zeke Emanuel about this. I work in precision medicine, and I said, well, you know, what do you think about precision medicine? And he looked at me and said, well, what's that going to do? And, you know, if you have cancer, it does a lot, right? You know, you take a magic bullet, melts your tumor away. Most people don't have cancer. He said, well, I'm talking about population health. And that's really the point. We spend a lot of money to treat very sick people, but in the end, it's not going to show up in the type of aggregate measures. And I think there are strong arguments for greater social spending to improve population health. For obesity, for example, is a huge problem here. It causes a great deal of, for example, diabetes, where we have inordinate amounts of diabetes. But the question is that healthcare? We treat the diabetes fine. The problem is we have obesity. The problem is we smoke. The problem is that people kill each other. The problem is that people die of overdoses. These are all social determinants that need to be addressed. They're not health. And having a single-payer Medicare for all system, which Mercatus Center projects would cost $33 to $40 trillion, would not address these issues.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Again, cost of single-payer healthcare does sound expensive because healthcare is expensive, but it's more expensive to keep private insurance industry in the game and to incentivize profit instead of healthcare. A friend of mine described it like having a Costco card, right? Or health insurance isn't getting health care. It just gives you a discount on everything in the store. It doesn't mean you can afford it. It doesn't mean if you get really ill or breast cancer, like my wife, even with a good living, threatening, has, we're having some financial issues. A lot of women who have breast cancer face bankruptcy. It's common. Like I said, I'm gonna repeat this important point. Most of the bankruptcies in this country come from medical expenses. And most of those people had health insurance when they got sick. I can just repeat that point all day long until I get that through, because I think it's really key. Again, you're paying people to make money. Now, if they were government bureaucrats, people would have no problem cutting them out, because everyone knows government bureaucrats are bad. But somehow these corporate bureaucrats, their jobs are more valuable than our lives. Healthcare results. We're not talking about the difference between second best and first best. We're talking about being the worst ranked country among wealthy nations. We're talking 19 out of 19. We're talking birth mother mortality rate. Now, let's think about that for a second. This crosses the ideological spectrum from left into right-wing evangelical values, voters, culture of life. These are our mothers and our babies being born. Infant mortality, birth mother mortality. 19 out of 19. It's unacceptable. And sure, there's a lot of mitigating factors, but any spending we do to fix that probably should go toward the remedy, toward the healthcare, not toward stockholders.
Okay, I'm gonna let Dr. Plan respond to that for a couple of minutes, and then be thinking too, if anyone in the audience has questions now that you've heard, either questions that have come up now or that you came into the room with, we'll get to those in a couple of minutes.
So I think, first of all, the reason that government programs like this tend not to be efficient or effective gets back to the notion of ways to spend money. So I encourage those of you to look online. Milton Friedman has a video. It's called The Four Ways to Spend Money. So the most effective and efficient ways to spend money are when people spend their own money on themselves. And you know that it's just intuitive, right? You're spending your money on yourself. You're most wise with it most of the time. When people spend other people's money on other people, that's when they're least concerned about how much they spend and how that money's spent. And unfortunately, the government-run systems act that way. We have physicians, I'm a physician. Even if doctors don't profit from spending, there's really not great incentives to do less. Patients want more. Patients have paid into the programs. They want to get something out of it. There's nobody putting on the brakes. If somebody isn't accountable, responsible for the bearing the costs, we have what we have now. We have a situation where you have no clue if you get sick as to what things cost. Nobody posts a price. You can't shop anything. I know somebody who went around looking for a chest x-ray because we're starting to get high deductible plans and then people have to kind of watch because it comes out of their pocket. Shopped around, chest x-ray, differences, $75 versus $400. The point of this is that if people have to have some responsibility, and this doesn't necessarily mean that it doesn't necessarily reflect on who provides the money, but what it does reflect on is what incentives are in the program. If people have an incentive to shop and to spend $75 versus $400, what you're going to see is you're going to see costs moderate, and you're going to see people posting prices. You're going to see better transparency with respect to outcomes, just like you do with any other commodity. It's very tragic, and I'm very sorry for you. And what you're going through with your wife. What I would say is that healthcare is very important, and particularly in these settings. But what we need to understand is that human beings behave in certain ways. And to try to, what we need to do when we build programs is to build in incentives so that people have, so that it's easier to so that they accommodate natural human behavior. And people normally, people are going to, who have a stake in the financial outcome of what they're doing. People who are spending money in which they have ownership are going to be far more wise with it. Providers have to respond in turn. And I think, that's, we have a system that is characterized by excessive, in the private sector as well, reliance on third-party payment. Oh.
We can come back to that. So at this point, does anyone have a question that they would like to ask? does anyone have a question first? Okay, you do.
Yeah. A lot of the issues today have been talking about money, and that's been the main focus. And of course, there's a substantial focus there. But what about privacy? In a single-payer healthcare system, I don't want the government necessarily knowing everything about me and my health. How do we reconcile those? The level of privacy that I want to retain as an American versus letting the government know everything about me.
Your question plays into the comment I wanted to make, actually. So let's be clear that this is just single-payer government insurance. It's not government-run healthcare. It's still privately owned. It's still privately run healthcare. There's still private hospitals. There's still doctors. There's actually more access now. But I want to keep my doctor. Well, guess what? Now you don't lose your doctor when your network changes, or you lose your job, or your employer decides, I can't afford this anymore. We're going to change it. Because now you got your card. And I know this sounds strange, because we're not defense contractors or bankers, all of us, presumably. So the idea of making our tax money work for us and do something positive for us and lighten our load is really very strange in today's climate. But that's what we're talking about doing, putting your tax money to work. You pay your taxes, put it to good use. Cover our insurance. Stop the labyrinth of networks and different and private public insurance. In Illinois, state Medicaid is 23.5% of the state budget, okay? I'm a township trustee. We insure our employees. This is a big problem. And even for unions, negotiating every time, we can eliminate a lot of bureaucracy, a lot of costs. I'm talking about making the cost cheaper. I'm talking about everybody in, nobody out, and no co-pays, no deductibles, no premiums. And also, finally, we could stop some of the price gouging by big pharma, because if you look at our comparative costs, the same drugs, they get Canada, that's why they're taking bus trips up to Canada. I was involved in an effort 15 years ago, busing seniors up to Canada. They're still doing that, trying to call attention to the fact that, hey, look, they're paying for the same drug that we're overpaying for here because there aren't price controls.
Dr. Klein, do you have anything?
Yeah, I do. I think you're concerned. So you're voicing a libertarian argument that healthcare and national health system could be used as a means of social control in a sense. They have access to your data, and that's true. I mean, but we do have other areas in which the government has access to our data. It's really the question is really would be a trade-off as to whether or not we think it's worth it. I mean, I think there's strong enough arguments against this that one doesn't need to go there. But I do appreciate what you're saying, because it's obviously been voiced. And we do have to recognize government, for example, if we know somebody smokes, for example, even in the Obamacare, you're allowed to change the premium versus whether somebody smokes. And we use government all the time through taxation and other ways to encourage or discourage certain behaviors. And there's no question that especially with computing power in today's world, that government could potentially have access to those to data about you, about and could exercise it in ways that, that maybe some people wouldn't like.
Is there anyone else that has a question?
I wanted to ask him a question.
Go ahead.
Do you trust an insurance corporation with your data more than you trust your government? Do you feel like there's no political agenda in that corporation, that CEO? I'm just wondering. I mean, because we're just talking about insurance here.
It's a fair question.
I mean, I'm just curious.
As far as my personal beliefs, I don't know if I necessarily trust either one, to be quite honest.
Okay, there you go.
So
if all things being equal, take the thing that gets you the better outcome and saves you money, right?
All right, thank you. So another question back there, yes?
Yeah, you were talking earlier about population health, and I couldn't agree more with you that money should be channeled towards social determinants of health, like paying more for housing, and some of the other things that impact people's health. I know since the implementation of the Affordable Care Act in 2014, there have been certain populations whose health outcomes have improved because they've had access to Medicaid and primary care services and things. And I guess my question is, do you think that population health improves by having access to preventative services? So like specifically for populations that maybe don't financially qualify for Medicaid, because they're not quite up to that level, but don't have access to like employer-based insurance and things like that.
Yeah, so I don't think the data actually support increased outcomes. And in fact, you often don't find people who are on Medicaid have better outcomes. And if you look at, for example, I'm a member of the American Society of Clinical Oncology. So we had data that came out that said people had earlier access to treatment. But we don't have data that shows that they actually lived longer or did better because of that earlier access. There's been some improvement in access, and particularly that study I'm familiar with, so I can cite that. But we don't have outcomes data to say that they actually did better. We have data that show that they had easier access. Yeah, and you know, often these in national systems, especially when you make it broad, people have less access because they have to wait. And so if you look at I know Japan, they're talking about people having to flooding emergency departments. They don't have access to primary care. They go to specialists themselves. I think one of the problems is to conflate medical care with sort of broader public health. And I remember a time I was sitting listening to it was a long time ago, but somebody talked about management of heart attacks. And the guy just looked up and he said, all of this, and it was talking about giving certain drugs. He said, all of this, he said, compared to seatbelts, it's nothing. And I think it's important to remember that when we talk about population health. And again, this is a different argument than medicine per se, but just to try to separate the two and not confuse issues. I think we need to understand that certain population measures, those are impacted by population-directed health. It's not medical care. It's not medicine. That's.
Yeah, you mentioned the ACA. I mean, ACA was a small step to do. Improved that outcome somewhat, but it didn't control the cost, and you saw there was a big backlash. And why didn't it control the cost? Because it kept the private insurers in the game. So as long as you have money grubbing instead of health, the issue of cost is still there. We're trying to cut the cost of health care. So for however much Medicare for All improved, expand Medicare for costs, remember, it's going to be a lot more with the, I said at least three times, probably five times greater overhead with private insurance.
Thank you. Okay, there's another question in the back.
Yeah, the comparison was made earlier between the Canadian system and the U.S. system as far as health care goes. And within the past couple of years, there was a case from the Canadian Supreme Court that it ruled mandatory participation in the single payer program there. They'd actually ruled it a human rights violation due to the excessive wait times and the effect that had on terminal cancer patients. And they basically required some sort of private option or access to a private option available. Would the single payer healthcare, if we tried that in the U.S., would it really be a viable competitor if you still have a private option available?
It's not a single payer system. You have, we're trying to streamline the bureaucracy. I find a lot of the, I don't have the, I should be better armed with the background on the Canadian system right now, but I don't really focus so much on what they're doing as to what we're suggesting here. I know a lot of these stories are blown up, they're mythos. I mean, I was in the limo business for a long time. I used to get a lot of corporate clients from Canada. And I mean, there's two things I always ask passengers. If they were married a long time, I asked them, what's your secret? And then if they were from Canada, I said, would you trade your system for ours? And not one, and these were business people, not Democratic Socialists or whatever. They were business people. And not one of them in 20 years ever said they would trade their system for what we have. The case you speak of, you're throwing something at me I never heard of. And I've never heard of that happening.
Yeah, I saw a recent poll in Canada, and the number one issue in that poll for Canadian voters was actually the healthcare system. So I think you have a legitimate point. At working at Cleveland Clinic, I know that we have people who came across the border. There's a lot of people who come across the border to get care here because of the wait times. It's unquestionable. You can't argue that there are certain instances where you, particularly for elective procedures or elective services, that wait times in these types of systems are longer. When you give something to somebody, and they, especially if they're paying into it through another vehicle, you give it to them. And they don't have to pay. You're going to have more demand than supply, and so you have to somehow ration services, and so you've got to have bureaucrats at the top who are saying, well, you can have this and you can have that, and you're this age, you can't have this, but if you're that age, you can have that, and we won't pay for this and we won't pay for that. We have that going on in the private sector too. We certainly have it going on. The government is harsher in many ways here, but you have to have some means to control utilization. It's just the way it is, and my argument would be that we need to move more toward a greater private system where people need to have greater control over the expenditures, where they have an interest in trying to spend money to obtain the highest value, which forces providers to be responsive to that and to become more transparent and to make their prices competitive with others. We need more competition, not less, would be my argument, and I think that fits with it.
Hey, what better way to control your healthcare system than being able to vote the people who don't provide it properly out of office, which you can't do with private control because it's some kind of entitlement.
Okay, we have another question here.
Dr. Klein had mentioned that with the more of the focus being on social detriments, costs being associated with, for instance, if you are, for example, a smoker, typically in private, your insurance premiums are a little bit higher. So with having some of that control over people participating in their responsibilities, having with their money going into their responsibilities, they are a little bit more cautious. Now, if we take the private sector away and it comes kind of this blanket insurance, blanket coverage, the cost would then potentially continue to rise as those social detriments are not covered so much anymore, not the focus on that, right? So how would you prevent the Medicare for All or the single payer, the taxes that we would all be paying into that should extremely rise as we continue as a society if all those focus on social detriments are being met with those private insurance kind of policies? So I mean, where would kind of be the stopping point on that? What kind of cap would we be looking at, potentially, say, 20 years down the road?
Okay. Who would like to comment first?
again, I'm talking about cutting costs. I've already pointed out that the private system has a vastly greater overhead. It is my primary assumption that the private system is taking a vast amount of money and diverting it into investors and CEOs' pockets and not at all providing for healthcare. So if you could just dispute that fundamental assumption, you'll see my argument may be flawed, but I don't see how that is.
But I wanted to address one thing, because we were talking about recourse versus the government and versus private. And since you're all lawyers, but lawyers to be, you do have, there is one thing that you can do, is you can sue them. And so this is, so you do have private sector recourse, which you don't have it so much against government. It's very hard to get anywhere, quite frankly, with governmental programs versus private. But anyway, I agree with your point, and I think that it sounds great, you know, especially the smart people. It sounds really great that we have a bunch of people sitting on top and we can, you know, tell everybody how they can move all the chess pieces around the chessboard, and all the smartest people in the world will hire McKinsey and they'll come in and they'll make everything cheaper. The problem is that individuals acting in a competitive way tend to produce the highest value outcomes. It's maybe contrary to intuition, but that's what works. Look at the student loan program. That was supposed to save us all kinds of money, and now it's the complete opposite. And I think every time the government gets involved, it's largely because of the same issue, where you have people, other people spending other people's money, and it even goes further because there tends to be so many political constraints. We have a system, Medicare, and it covers end-stage renal disease. Why does it cover end-stage renal disease? Why no other disease? Why not ovarian cancer? If you have end-stage renal disease, why are you on Medicare? Because it's political. That lobby was strong enough to get inserted into the Medicare program.
All right, thank you. One more question in the right back.
Yeah, so my general philosophy is that rights trump costs. Right? So rights, that if we can establish...
Rights trump what? I'm sorry to hear.
Rights trump costs. So if we can establish that there is a right first, and then the cost analysis is secondary. So my intuition is that healthcare is a right. And that's my intuition. But I don't know that I can necessarily defend that intellectually. So how can we establish that it is a right?
I'll defend it constitutionally. The purpose of the federal government is to provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare. That's why the government was established. And we do have remedy without trying suing a multinational corporation. Good luck trying to take Blue Cross, Blue Shield to court. Hey, guess what? We have people dying just because they don't want to deal with the bills. I can't afford to live. We have plenty of people in this country dying. Now, if you come from a wealthy, privileged background, you wouldn't know this, because guess what? With the incentivization towards money, in the wealthy areas, our system's great. In the city I grew up in, I'm from Rogers Park. Anyone else from the city? All right. In Chicago, 2L stops down, your life expectancy can drop 20 years. When I enlisted in the Marines and when I was 17, it wasn't for that America. It was like an America, a democracy of all of us, we the people, not just the wealthy people, and certainly not for a special interest like health insurance corporations. Why are they more entitled than the lives of working people? I don't get that. I don't get it.
Were your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a consensus that in this country, for example, that people with pre-existing conditions should have access to affordable health care. I think that there's a consensus that people should get medical care who need medical care. That's why emergency departments, for example, can't turn people away. The question is what's the best way to accomplish that? What's the most effective and efficient way to accomplish that? Do we need to essentially gut an entire system and replace it with something that seems unlikely to provide the benefits that we want and seems almost certain to cost far more than it ought to.
That's
what we need
okay,
to do is
we're
move
have
the
to
other
wrap up.
Way.
But thank you so much for the spirited debate.
Anyone want to get on the list and get more information, especially about that Canadian system? I hear a lot of ghost stories about that, but it doesn't seem to bear out on further investigation, though. It's a nightmare.